In this video, I'm going to look at demo text, practice text, and why I advocate always maintaining them separately. So I'm looking at a simulation here, and I have, as you know, a demo text and a practice text, and they contain different things. Now there is an option here called Use Text From, and you can use that to choose to use the text from one of those modes in both modes. So here I can choose to maintain only the demo mode text and have that also used in practice mode. Or I can choose to use the practice mode text and have that always used in demo mode. But I do like to maintain those things separately. And the main reason for that is that there's really a difference in how they're used. The demo text obviously is used in demo mode and the practice text in practice mode. Now in practice mode, you need to give users the data that they need to execute that step in the system so they can progress to the next step. So you need to give them that data. In this case, I need to tell them to type in SAP Enable Now support so that they see so that they can progress to the next step. The demo text, however, in demo mode, progression is usually automatic. The user doesn't have to type in anything themselves. They just watch it unfold. Now, I like my demo modes to be completely hands-off and advance completely automatically. And that's an important thing to bear in mind here. So while they're doing that, we don't need to give them the data. And I explicitly do not give them the data in demo mode. They can see it on the screen if they really need to refer to it. But I don't like to put the values hard-coded into my demo texts. And the reason for that is that the demo text is used in some other areas. It's used in the documentation normally, and it's also used in concurrent mode. In fact, it's used in pretty much every mode apart from practice mode and test mode. But concurrent mode, you're often using that for in-application help. You're launching that via SAP Companion or SAP Companion for desktop. Now, the important thing with these two things here, with the document and with the concurrent mode or any mode that you're using for in-application help, is that users are referring to that as they're performing the step in the actual system. And that's an important distinction here. It is really guidance. It's not training at this point. It's help while they're in the flow of work. So I don't like to have hard-coded data values visible there. So you can see here, I do not have the data value in the document, and I do not have it in what here is concurrent mode. And that's because I will guarantee that if you put a value in there, even if you prefix it with, for example, you're going to find that you have users who aren't sure exactly what value they're going to put in there, so they'll just enter whatever they see in the documentation because they know it's a valid value or because they don't know any better. And that's normally not what you want, because it could be an invalid value in their particular circumstances. It might be just test data. So you don't really want that hard-coded data in demo mode, so it doesn't appear in the documentation and it doesn't appear in the in-app help. So that's why I generally have a difference between those two modes. In the demo text, I have only instructions. And then in practice, I have the instructions and the data. Now, I do get arguments every so often from authors that they don't have time to maintain two different sets of text, that it takes too much effort, it's going to take twice as long to do everything, so they only want to maintain one. That's absolutely false and it's lazy. It shouldn't be done. Maintaining those two texts is not twice as much effort, because as you can see here, the first paragraph is exactly the same in both of them. It's only the second paragraph that you really need to do anything different. So I'm going to show you how quick it is to make these changes. I've got here another example, input text, exactly the same field that we're filling out. But here I've got exactly the I've got only the text that's been brought in from the recording dictionary when the simulation was recorded. So this has not been edited yet. And I'm just going to edit these and I'll show you how much effort it takes to maintain one of them, which you're absolutely going to have to do, versus maintaining both of them. So if I go into here for my demo text, I would want to say, for example, let's see, enter your job title in the function field. And then I want to say this should be the as your same as is used in the HR system. So that's my instructions. Okay. And now all I'm going to do is I'm going to copy that exact text. I'm going to go down to my practice text. I'm going to paste it in there. And then I'm going to form my second paragraph, which is for this T, enter, blah, blah, blah. And I'm going to take off this last little bit on the end because it's reductive at that point. And that's it. Okay. So it's not twice the effort. It's an extra second maybe. But what it gives us is something that's more usable for the learners and that's a bit more flexible and makes a bit more sense. Now, I go one step further than that. That was using just a standard recording dictionary. I actually edit the recording dictionary myself on most of my implementations. And that's what I've done with this third example I'll show you here. I've already started to mold this to be what I want it to be. So here, for example, my demo text says, enter the appropriate value into the function field. And here's where I would change the appropriate value to your job title. Okay, and then just copy that and paste it into the top of my practice text, which already has for this activity, enter a value of, and I've still got that into the function field at the end. And the reason why I do this is because I accept that not all of my authors are as diligent as I am about the text. So I want it to work even if they do nothing. If they don't touch this text at all, this will work. The demo text of enter the appropriate value into the function field and the practice text of for this activity, enter a value of X into the field Y. It will absolutely still work if they do nothing. Obviously, I want them to go in and edit these things, but if they don't, it's still going to work. Nothing's going to look weird to the users. I don't have enter place value here into the or any type of boilerplate text, because again, if they change nothing, that's not going to work. So this will work for me. So change your recording dictionary to get it closer to what you want it to be, except you're going to have to do some editing to it. And it's not really that much effort to change to maintain the demo text and the practice text separately. Now, this is all important for the input text. Now, if I go and look at an explanation bubble here, the text is exactly the same because there's no data that they have to type in. Most of the time with my explanations, it's exactly the same text. But you'll see that there's a similar option to what we had before of use text from here. It's actually been implemented a bit different and it's a bit inconsistent, but it does the same thing. Here I've got a checkbox of use demo bubble for practice. So if this is not selected, which is the default, then I'm going to maintain demo text and practice text separately. If I select it and say, yes, I want to use a demo bubble in practice mode, then the practice text has now disappeared and I've only got one text to maintain. And you could say, well, it's exactly the same text. Why wouldn't you want to do that? The simple reason is, again, I like my demo modes to be 100% automatic. Okay. Now, for demo mode on every type of bubble, you have a property called display duration. I often see this isn't maintained, but it absolutely should be. This is how long that bubble is going to be displayed on the screen before the action is performed and it continues on to the next step. And you should always adjust that so that the learner has time to read what's in the bubble. By default, it's 4 seconds. Here, I'm allowing 8 seconds for them to read that. But again, demo mode, I want it to be automatic. So I want this display duration to automatically advance after 8 seconds. However, in practice mode, we also have a display duration only on explanation bubbles, okay? On bubbles for input text or for mouse actions or anything else, that we don't have the display duration because the flow of the activity is controlled by the learner who's actually carrying out it in practice mode. So it's automatically going to advance when they type in the required text or when they click on the required button or whatever else. For explanations, there's no action associated with it. So there you have the learner has to do something themselves. And that's usually clicking on the next button or continue as I've configured it here. But what you can have is have it set, have the display duration set to -1, which means it's going to sit there forever until they click that next button, which is generally what I want because, again, they're controlling the flow of the playback. So I can't, if I have up here, use demo bubble for practice, I've now got no practice bubble in here. And in practice mode, it's going to use that same display duration that I have for my demo bubble. So it's going to display this for 10 seconds and then it's going, sorry, for 8 seconds, and then it's going to go on to the next step. And I don't want that in practice mode. I mean, is it going to break anything? No, but maybe the learner is in the habit of referring to something else and going through and performing the steps, and then suddenly the explanation bubbles all auto-advance before they've had the chance to read it, because they weren't expecting it to do that because they're controlling the flow of action. So because of that one field in here, I always like to maintain these texts separately, because now I can have a demo bubble with a display duration of 8, which is display it for 8 seconds and then move on. And in practice, I've got it set to -1, which effectively means forever, of sit there until they click the next button. So that is literally the only field that I have different between my demo bubble and my practice bubble. Everything else, the style, the width, the height, exactly where it's positioned, is exactly the same. But because I want to have this one field of display duration maintained separately for those two things, I have to maintain the bubble text separately as well. But again, it's not like you're having to type all of this in twice. You're typing it into demo text, copy, move to the practice text, paste. It's a split second to do that. It's not extra, really extra effort in the grand scheme of things. If it's taking you 2 hours to edit a simulation anyway, that's going to add another half a second per explanation bubble. And it's absolutely worth it to make things more intuitive and logical for the learners. So I will absolutely do that. The last thing where you could maybe argue that you really don't need to maintain two separate bubbles is where we've got pure mouse clicks. So here I've got a mouse action of click on the enter button. And this is 100% exactly the same. There is no display duration on the practice bubble because it's going to advance as soon as they click on that button. So it is, everything is 100% exactly the same. So I could argue here, sure, I may as well go and set that to use only the demo mode and maintain only one of those. However, I personally find it easier to be consistent, and it saves me having to think, oh, is this one where the text is the same? Yeah, let me go and change this property. If it's just a copy and paste, it's quicker for me to come into here, copy that text, paste it into this one, than it is to say, oh, let me go and change this property here and go and set it to what it should be. And I don't have to think about, do I need to do this here or not? I'm just consistent in all of my actions, always use text from each mode, and then I don't really have to think about stuff too much. It becomes second nature. You know exactly how things are going to be, even if you're just copy and pasting that same exact text. So that's why I like to maintain these two texts separately. I think they've got different purposes, especially when you think about the document and the in-application support, which should be using concurrent mode. By default, SAP, in SAP Companion, they have it set to use, I think it's set to use the practice mode, which doesn't make sense. Even demo mode doesn't really make sense there. Concurrent mode is great because it shows you the step, then they have to click next to go on to the next step. So, again, I always maintain these steps separately. I absolutely think it's worth doing that every time, every action, every simulation. I think it makes a better product. Don't be lazy. Do things the right way. If it takes you an extra couple of minutes for your whole simulation, think about the number of learners that are going to play back that simulation time and time again, how often it's going to be used, and a little bit of hardship on your part of maintaining these two separate texts will absolutely make it a better product for all of those learners every time they go through this. So value add, it's absolutely worth it. Okay, that's my pitch. Thanks for watching.